Yeah, thank you, John, for the introduction. I have no idea what you were talking about, but it seems like you were introducing yourself. Thanks, John. Yeah, I'm Stefan George. I'm CTO of Gnosis. Who of you has heard about Gnosis before? Okay, quite a few, yeah. So basically, Gnosis started in beginning of 2015 as part of a company called Consensus, which is, I think by now, probably the biggest crypto company in terms of employees at least. And we started off building a prediction market framework. Today, I will not talk about prediction markets. Today, I will talk about decentralized exchanges. And specifically, I will talk about something that we call the Dutch Exchange. And the Dutch Exchange is an open trading protocol to allow for trading ERC20 tokens. Like there are many on Ethereum today and getting more and more. So the origin of this specific exchange goes back to our own token sale. So we did our own ICO last year in April. And we were using a new mechanism to do this ICO. We were the first ones to use a so-called Dutch auction to sell our token and raise Ether in return. Yeah, so we used an auction where we were auctioning off GNO tokens for Ether. And we were using an auction mechanism because we wanted to let the market decide the value of our company. Yeah, so if you look at previous ICOs, going back even to Ethereum, then the models of how an ICO was done was always different. For Ethereum, for example, what they did was we just raise as much money as we can within this amount of time. Yeah, the token sale will last for, like, say, 30 days, and we just raise as much money as we can. And then everyone gets proportionally to what they invested, the tokens, in that case, Ether. And the downside of this is that you don't really know until the end what your share is in this protocol or in this token, because in the last minute, someone can put in a huge amount and can get the majority of tokens. And that's why we decided against this model. Another model was that I think many used was like Golem, for example, just saying we evaluate our own company. We say the value of our company is, for example, $10 million, and now you can just buy this token. And previously, like, this model really didn't work well because all the ICOs were over within very few minutes. So basically, the companies themselves, they undervalued their token, and that's why it was sold so quickly. And that's why we thought, okay, instead of redefining the value of our token or just raising as much money as possible, what we do instead is we are using an auction to let the market decide what the value of our company is. And now if you think about ICOs, what you do is you raise Ether or you raise another token and you give another token in return. In our case, we raised Ether and we gave away GNO tokens. This is already an exchange of tokens, right? There is already an exchange. And it's a mechanism in our case that allowed the market to decide the fair value of the token and allowed everyone to get the same price for the token, yeah? Because the auction defines the final clearing price. And that's the origin of this protocol. So now let's have a look at how exchanges are working today. Today, all of you probably have traded on exchange. So today, what every exchange is using is something called an order book model. Now this here is an aggregated order book where you can see, like here are bids, like the buy orders, this here is the ask, the sell orders, and you can see that there's a spread between those two. And now how a traditional order book works, it's actually something called continuous auction. So continuously, people can post orders, buy and sell orders. If it's a market order, then it's immediately executed. if it's a limit order, then eventually it stays in the order book and is just added to this graph here. And the issue here is that this here requires continuous time. Yeah, here we have a continuous auction, continuously orders coming in, continuously orders are matched. And this continuous time doesn't exist on blockchain. Yeah, blockchain only knows block time. You are collecting transactions on blockchain over time, and then when a miner mines a block, he mines all the transactions at once, so the transactions are batched. And yeah, so this comes with a lot of issues. And this is not only true for actually decentralized exchanges, but also for centralized exchanges, because using this continuous auctions leads to those issues here. Yeah? The main issue is front running. So front running is the issue that there's one entity which has an information advantage and is able to act faster, is able to front run other traders. So to give an example, let's say you're on an exchange and there's someone who places a buy order for Ether, a huge buy order for Ether, and this buy order is driving the price for Ether up. If you are the exchange and you know someone's placing this order, then theoretically, or also practically, you could place your own buy order first before executing the other big buy order. You buy it at a cheaper price, and then just immediately after you process the big buy order, you are selling the Ether token again and have a guaranteed profit. Yeah. And this is called front running. And this is an inherent problem of blockchains, because this entity in blockchain, this can be many parties. For example, miners. Yeah? Miners in Ethereum, as well as in Bitcoin and all the other blockchains, they define which transactions are included and what the transaction ordering is. So what I just described, this transaction processing, like buy and sell transactions, all this can be manipulated to extract value out of the system at the expense of the original trader. Yeah, and then other issues are that are also known is overlapping order books. So there is actually even arbitrage opportunities in many cases even on the same exchange. So if you have multiple token pairs, for example, trading any kind of token with Bitcoin, and they have different prices for Bitcoin, then there's even on the same exchange an arbitrage opportunity. Yeah? And this comes all from the fact that you have this continuous order book model that doesn't allow to combine different tokens in one auction together. Yeah. And then another issue is, and that's also a big issue for most projects, that if you have an order book model and you have a token where there's not a lot of liquidity, then you have a big spread between bid and ask. So you will see this on any kind of exchange where there's a token traded, where there are few people actually trading, that the gap here between bid and ask is becoming bigger. And in the end, if you as a trader, if you want to trade, then you will always have to pay the spread in addition. Yeah? So it just becomes less and less attractive for you to trade. And that's something that also, of course, happens on decentralized exchanges as well as on centralized exchanges. So now that we understand what this issue here is, how can we try to solve this? We believe this order book model should not be ported on Ethereum. Today, everyone tries to use the order book model on blockchain, every decentralized exchange, but it comes with all the flaws, so let's change this. Let's use something called a batch auction instead of a continuous auction. So what we do is, instead of continuously processing orders, we collect orders over time, and then we settle them all at once, and we define a single clearing price per token. How can this be done? The simplest way we found to implement this is, again, the Dutch auction. Yeah? To explain how Dutch auction works, so this here is a graph of a Dutch auction. In a Dutch auction, you start with a very high price, and then this price goes down over time. And in case of trading tokens, what you are trying to do is you try to sell tokens. So you start with a very high price per token that is being sold. Then the price goes down, 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 and people start bidding. They are basically signaling, I am willing to buy this token at this price. And at some point, the buy volume times the current price is equal to the sell volume. And at this point, the auction stops and the final clearing price is defined. Yeah. So that's the big advantage. Everyone will get the same price. And this is why front running is not an issue anymore. Yeah, if the entity that can manipulate the transaction ordering will get the same price as everyone else, well, then there is no advantage for this entity anymore. And it also signals a true willingness to pay from bidders which are participating. They're saying basically, if I place my bid here, then I know I will get this price here, for example, or the price will just continuously go down, so I get just get a better price. Yeah, so there's no risk for the buyer, for the bidder. So how does this continuously work? For every token which is traded, every token pair that's traded, there is one auction, or there are actually two auctions. So if there's the token pair GNO versus Ether, or token A versus token B, then there are always two auctions, the auction where you sell token A for token B and vice versa. And the states of those auctions are, the first state is prior to the auction where sellers that just want to sell their tokens, they deposit the token into the auction, and at a certain point of time a threshold is reached and the auction can start. And then you cannot add anything anymore to this auction. The auction will start at some point. The amount that's the bidding amount times the current price is the sell amount. At this point, we define the clearing price and the auction is over, and then everyone can claim their tokens. Yeah. The way how we design this curve is that it will always start at twice the price of the previous auction. So, for example, if the previous auction ended at $30 per GNO token, then the next auction will start at $60 per GNO token. Then the price will go down over time. And after 6 hours, this auction will, the price for GNO tokens will fall down to the previous auction final price, which is $30. So the assumption is that on average, after 6 hours, the auction will probably end if the price didn't fluctuate a lot during this time, and then the next auction can start. So yeah, again, like we always have like the two auctions at the time, like selling token A for token B and vice versa. After the auction ends, there's a 10-minute gap, so people can submit their tokens if they want to continuously trade into the next auction. And an auction only starts if there's at least $1,000 worth of volume in the auction, just to make sure that there's enough liquidity to attract bidders to also participate. And yeah, the end of an auction is always when the last bid is finally adding up to the required bidding volume, or maybe no one's actually interested in this token, then after 24 hours, the price will go down to zero, meaning that your token was worthless. But then also, well, then probably also the whole auction doesn't make much sense if you are selling a token which no one actually wants to have. Yeah, so the length of the auction really depends on the price. On average, it should be 6 hours. If no one's interested, it will end after 24 hours. And yeah, this will just continuously go on over time. So you have the phase where sellers deposit tokens and bidders can bid. During the time when bidders can bid, the next auction can already be funded. And yeah, this just continuously goes on over time. So we can see that this is a kind of an exchange where it's very different depending on if you are a seller or if you are a buyer. So a seller just has to deposit tokens, and then the seller just waits until the auction is over. And this is something that anyone can do. It's nothing sophisticated. You don't have to think about it. You just deposit your tokens. That's it. That's why we think anyone can use this to sell tokens. But if you're a bidder, then you're probably, you have to be a much more advanced user, because you actually have to wait until the auction price goes down to a price that you are willing to also pay. And that's why we expect that bidders will more likely be experienced traders, eventually market makers. Of course, it can be anyone, but they have to be a bit more experienced. And then what is the use case for such an exchange? So this here is an exchange that is fully decentralized. And if you think about the definition of decentralized, then for most, they just use this term if they actually mean non-custodial, right? They say it's non-custodial, we don't own your token, you are in control of your tokens. But there are still elements which are centralized, yeah? Maintaining the order book off-chain, for example. And that's why you kind of still have to ask for permission to list your token. Now, if you want to list your token on 0x, on EtherDelta, then there's still someone who has to maintain this order book, and he can basically decide on if he wants to have your token there as well or not. With our exchange, that's not the case, because it's fully on-chain. Everything is on-chain. There is no off-chain order book. It's not required. That's why everyone can just list their new token project without asking us for permission. And that's, of course, the case for most projects today, because there are lots of ICOs, lots of tokens, which will never be added to any of the centralized exchanges, and also not to the decentralized exchanges, which are, in fact, just non-custodial, but not fully decentralized. Another thing is that those projects, they have most of the time very low liquidity. Yeah? So if they would use a regular order book, this will always result in a big bid-ask spread, because there's hardly anyone trading it. This would make it really not attractive for anyone to participate in these trades at all. And that's why for such tokens specifically, an auction which is collecting basically liquidity over time by just collecting orders over time is much better. Another use case is buybacks, for example, for token projects. Yeah? So if you want to do a buyback today as a project, you can do it, you can announce it, but you cannot transparently do it. Now, using this Dutch exchange, we fund the auction where Gene O is sold for Ether, and we fund the auction with Ether, which is then sold for Gene O to buy back our own token. And this can be done in a very transparent way. It's also great to convert larger amount of tokens, because you know in the end what you actually do when you place a sell order is you are placing a slowly executed market order, because you as a seller, you take whatever the market is willing to pay. It's a market order, but it is secure because it's slowly executed, and finally only after hours the final clearing price will be defined. Another cool thing is, because it doesn't require an order book, it is purely based on a smart contract. It doesn't require a private key to sign anything. Yeah? So if you want to trade, for example, on 0x or EtherDelta, you can only do this today if you have, if the one who is placing order has a private key. But smart contracts don't have a private key. No, they cannot sign such orders, so they cannot participate. Using this exchange, you can directly integrate other smart contracts into this exchange, and this opens a door for lots of new integrations which were not possible before. Yeah, so as I mentioned, it's a decentralized, fully decentralized exchange, so everyone can list their token, and listing token is very simple. You just have to start an auction where you're selling off Ether worth $10,000 for the token that you would like to list. And yeah, that's basically all that you have to do. And then you have basically based on this auction, we define then the price for the next auction. And this just continuously goes on. So in this exchange, we have a few tokens. And just yesterday, I realized that the Dutch exchange is also what you call a mining exchange. Because we have a token called Magnolia, which is this token which is mined or issued, minted within this exchange. And for every Ether worth of trade, one Magnolia token is minted. Yeah, so you just continuously collect those Magnolia tokens. The more you trade, the more tokens you have. Yeah. And Magnolia tokens themselves can also be traded. Yeah, they are yours, they're tradable. And what Magnolia tokens are for is they allow you to do fee reduction. Yeah, if you hold a certain percentage of Magnolia tokens, you get a fee reduction. The default fee in this exchange is 0.5%. This fee doesn't go to us. This fee stays within the ecosystem, meaning that this fee, if a fee is charged in an auction, this fee is added to the sell volume of the next auction. Yeah, so just incentivizes to continuously trade on this exchange, because if you do this, then you actually never pay this fee. And if you have Magnolia token, you actually have an advantage compared to everyone else on the exchange, because you pay less. Yeah, you pay less of this 0.5% fee. In case you hold 10% of all Magnolia, you actually don't pay any fee. So you just basically earn money because you have a competitive advantage to everyone else trading on this exchange. Yeah. Another way to have fee reduction is to use the OWL token. So as you may know, Gnosis, we were selling the GNO tokens. And with GNO tokens, GNO tokens are kind of like fee coupon generators. And this fee coupon is what we call OWL. Now, these are OWL tokens. And every OWL token is worth $1 worth of fees. So instead of paying the fee in the token that you're trading, you can just pay it with OWL tokens, yeah, which are then burned. Yeah, so basically, per default, you pay 0.5% fee. In case you have Magnolia, it's reduced to eventually no fee. Remaining fees can be paid with OWL tokens. And yeah, we will never get any of the fee. The fee is always contributed to the next auction. So let's sum up. What are the advantages of the Dutch exchange? As I mentioned, yeah, the main advantage is no front-running possibility. Also an advantage is that there's less price volatility, because the price is defined in this auction approximately every 6 hours. And it's not possible to easily manipulate the price short-term, because you just have to wait for the auction to end to define the final clearing price. It's also more gas efficient than other decentralized exchanges today, or at least most, not Kyber Network. So for example, if you use an order book exchange like EtherDelta, then what you will see is that the order book is available for everyone, and many would like to fill the same order, you know, but only one can. And that's why, like, the best orders try to be filled by many. Only one succeeds, everyone else fails. But because it's Ethereum, they still have to pay for this. Yeah. And they even have to pay for cancellation of orders. So all this costs money. In our case, it doesn't cost money, because first of all, you cannot even cancel your order. That's not even an option. And secondary, because you don't try to fill one order, you just add it to a batch auction, you know that if you want to sell tokens, that you will get tokens in return. There's no way your order will fail. The only option that an order can fail is that if you are sending a bid to buy the tokens, it's basically bidding on the auction, and the auction has already closed, that then basically the last transaction might fail. The disadvantage, of course, is that it's very slow. Yeah, I think especially here in South Korea, people expect to trade instantly. Every second, oh, the price changed, ah, let me buy more, sell, whatever. This doesn't work in this case, obviously. You have to be, you just have to wait. You have to be patient. You have to wait approximately 6 hours before you can redeem your tokens. But you have the advantage that you will get a fair price for this token, that you're not paying too much, and that you know this cannot be manipulated by any third party on this exchange, like high frequency traders, or eventually even the exchange itself, or third parties. Yeah. Again, this is the exchange that can be easily integrated into other programs. So, for example, one application that we have in mind is shorting of tokens. There's so many tokens where people are really questioning if this token actually represents something that can have value on the long term. But today, you cannot really easily short a token on a decentralized network, because what you need for shorting is the possibility to lend tokens. And this is now possible with such an exchange. You can build a smart contract which allows you to say, I am lending out a token for another token, and then in this contract you can define that this contract will automatically convert this token back if the price falls below a certain threshold using such an exchange. Yeah. And this is only possible because here we know no private key is required. Any smart contract can directly integrate with this exchange. Another interesting side effect of this exchange is that because we have all those auctions, which are very, very difficult to manipulate, you can use the information in the smart contract as a secure, reliable price oracle for other smart contracts. Yeah? So as soon as you add a new token to this exchange, you know we will continuously have prices which are reliable. They will not change every minute, only every 6 hours, but they are reliable. So, we see the Dutch exchange as an open protocol. What does that mean? So we have these smart contracts. You don't have to ask for anyone for permission to use them. So you can start building your own interfaces around those. Yeah? So we have built a seller interface. Maybe someone wants to build a bidder interface. Maybe someone wants to integrate it into wallets. That's all possible. You don't have to ask anyone for permission. The second layer is on-chain apps. So, for example, prediction markets can use this decentralized exchange to trade outcome tokens which are created within the prediction markets. DAOs could use it to convert tokens. And as I just mentioned, like lending contracts would be super interesting. This can all be done. And then on smart contract level, of course, there's also a lot of things that can be done. You could build a transaction scheduler. So right now, basically, it would require the user to be online at the time when he wants to bid on an auction. You could also have a transaction scheduler just saying, okay, whenever the price falls below this, then just incentivize someone to just send the transaction by paying a small reward for this. Yeah, and again, like a side effect is we have this price feed that's interesting for wallets, for dApps, for crypto funds. So I think we will see more and more of those. Eventually, I think Kyber Network will also have probably some sort of price information, of obviously also in the smart contract. So what I can see is that ultimately we will have price feeds which are using these different exchanges as a source to power decentralized dApps and gives this information also to wallets and so on. So, yeah, I mentioned it's a fully decentralized exchange, and you can define this in different steps or different levels. So again, like milestone one is what we defined as non-custodial, and that's what every decentralized exchange probably has. That's like kind of the minimum, non-custodial. You always have control over your tokens. But you can go even further. Yeah? So milestone one is for us that we would like to actually don't have control over the smart contract anymore at all. Like, we want that this decentralized exchange is governed by those who are actually using it. Yeah? So this, an exchange is a more complex program. So you want to have the possibility to change the exchange after deployment at some point. And you can, of course, do this by just saying, OK, this private key is allowed to update it. And you can make it a bit more trustworthy by just saying, OK, if you want to do an update of this contract, you have to wait for a couple of days before you can actually do it. And everyone who disagrees with the update can withdraw their tokens. But that's still not really decentralized. So what you actually want to have, you want to have a DAO who is actually in charge of governing this. And that's exactly what we are doing. Yeah, we are collaborating with a company called DAOStack, which has already implemented the required governance structures. And yeah, we will use this DAO hopefully very soon to actually govern this exchange. Yeah. This is also interesting, of course, for many other reasons. It's not only about just governance, it's also about responsibility. Yeah? If you build such an exchange where everyone's able to list tokens, then you don't want to be the one who is actually responsible for eventually still being able to interfere in this process. Right? Then milestone two is, okay, we have this contract. Like, on contract level, everything is fully decentralized. The contract itself, like the participation, is decentralized, doesn't need any off-chain information. It's governed by a DAO, not by a private key or multisig wallet. But then you still have the front end. Yeah? You still have the front end, which is currently, by all projects, almost all projects, served centrally over a web server. And our goal is that also this part is decentralized. And with the last updates also on MetaMask, it's actually possible to use ENS, the Ethereum name service, to resolve ENS domains to IPFS objects. So basically, you can host, you can upload your front end to IPFS, and then you can reference the IPFS hash of your index file in ENS, and this way, if you're going to DutchX.eth or another domain, then you will see the interface. And of course, this ENS entry can also be controlled by the DAO. So the DAO does not only have the possibility to upgrade the smart contract, but it can also upgrade the front end. And yeah, that's kind of like the full package, where everything is fully decentralized, and that's exactly what we want to do with the Dutch exchange. So if we have a look at like what can the DAO actually do on smart contract level, there are a few parameters that can be changed. So for example, a threshold to add new tokens, currently $10,000 worth of Ether is required. The threshold of starting auctions, like how much self-funding has to be available to, in order to start the next auction. Then we were talking about this, mining exchange, the mining of Magnolia. Of course, you can only mine Magnolia for tokens which are legit. Otherwise, you could create your fake token, just continuously trade the token with, with yourself. That's why this has to be whitelisted. That's also a process. This has to be done, of course, by the DAO. Then we have the ETH US dollar price feed. So again, like we always assume value being referenced in US dollars. So we need a US dollar price feed. That's of course centralized information. Currently we are using the one that's provided by MakerDAO. And to update this, this of course has to have also some sort of delay, because otherwise the DAO could easily manipulate the exchange, and this should not be possible. Same for updating the contract itself. You know, these like very critical updates, which can lead to manipulation or eventually stealing user funds, those kinds of updates, they have to have a huge time delay. So anyone who disagrees with such updates has the opportunity to withdraw their tokens. Same is also true, of course, for updating the ENS entry. If you want to update the front end, you want to make sure that they're not adding any possible attack vectors. And there should be time for everyone to review this before this can be done. And the last option is just to basically update the DAO itself. So if you have a new kind of DAO that should be in control over this exchange, then this, of course, also has to be triggered by the DAO itself. Yeah, then the DAO has to be governed. And the main question, if you want to do governance, is, of course, how do you distribute the voting rights? And we want to distribute the voting rights mostly to those that are actually trading on the exchange. So if you are trading early on, then you get these Magnolia tokens, which are mined while you're trading. And most of the REP tokens, which are the tokens that are used for voting in this exchange and changing parameters, those are credited to mostly Magnolia holders. There's also a percentage which will be credited to GNO token holders under the assumption they are locking their tokens down. So not every GNO token holder will get tokens, but everyone who's willing to lock their tokens down for a certain period of time. And we even allow this for Ether. The reason is we want to basically include everyone who has an interest in this exchange. And that's why a certain percentage, a smaller percentage, will also go just to Ether holders. And just as just for fun, we will also, so basically at DEPCON, this was our conference that we were doing in Berlin, every participant got an Ether card. So they all got kind of a private key. And all of them will receive voting rights in this DAO. Yeah, so the cool thing is this exchange is finally about to go live. It took quite a while, but it's actually already live on mainnet. This version, which is currently live on mainnet, will be updated one time, or will be replaced with a version that's actually controlled by the DAO. The version that's currently on mainnet is one where we set the auctioneer, like the critical part, to just zero. So no one can do any update. That's why this is an exchange which is only used for limited time. But it gives everyone the opportunity to test the exchange already even on mainnet. There's, of course, also a version on the test network on Rinkeby. But it's also already on mainnet. Just to give you a short overview of how the smart contracts look like. So we are using proxy contracts. This concept allows you to upgrade the functionality of the exchange itself. So we have the DX master, which actually implements the logic. Yeah? And they have the proxy, which is just forwarding all the transactions to the master to execute the the logic, but everything is stored within the proxy. Yeah, so all the tokens are stored in the proxy, and whenever you want to upgrade the logic, then you just change the reference, the address of the master copy. Yeah, and this way, we are able to change the logic without asking users to withdraw the tokens from the old contract and depositing them into the new token, into the new contract. We're using the same concept also for our OWL contract, which is this fee reduction mechanism. Yeah. So why? Yeah.
In the Dutch, the proxy. How do you? So let's say you change the calls.
Yeah.
On the master. How do you, like, what if the call doesn't exit on DX proxy? Because, like, you're sending the calls through DX proxy.
Exactly.
So how do you, like, if...
So for developers, we are basically this here, this DX proxy. Sorry. The DX proxy uses this fallback function to forward all the requests.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, so I can show...
Is that implemented by...
Yeah, so yeah, that's possible. So basically, the DX proxy doesn't implement any logic. It just says, whatever you send to me, I will forward it. Yeah, basically, I will do this delegate call. Yeah, I will just basically execute it as if this here would be this contract. And yeah, this is like a very nice way to allow for upgrading contracts. And that's why we use it now everywhere, because that's the leanest way to implement this. So developers, like who of you is actually a developer? Okay, there are a few developers. Cool. So the reason why you should be interested in this exchange is because it is the first fully decentralized exchange. Yeah, it is run by a DAO. It is, doesn't require any off-chain part, which is controlled by a central entity. It is a mining exchange, so being in early is definitely interesting. And also, there's no fee extraction, which just goes to GNO token holders, but the fees, they stay within the ecosystem. We want to incentivize developers also with our Gnosis X challenge. So we will continuously post bounties for specific implementations. So there are lots of integrations that are possible. The one thing I mentioned was this lending contract, that's one. But there could also be, for example, a contract to pool liquidity to start an auction, maybe not only one person is responsible for providing liquidity to add a new token pair. You can pool this. So there are lots of small things that we think would be useful to have, maybe implementing a bidder interface, like just integrating it into other existing applications. So we will start just posting bounties and incentivize developers to understand how the system works and just implement it. We just hope also that this is actually currently a new piece of infrastructure that has not been there before. And it is useful for others to have something that's fully permissionless. It's like a new kind of building block which was missing in the ecosystem. And yeah, we hope people will use it and also benefit from the side effects like the decentralized price feed and so on. Also, if you're a developer and you're interested in smart contract programming, there's an still ongoing bug bounty for the contracts. They have been severely audited, but yeah, you never know. Maybe you find something. We have also a very detailed documentation about all the Dutch exchange contracts. And we also already provide some of the core functionality that's required to interact with this. So we have liquidity bots. So let's say you add a new token, then anyone can start an auction, but most likely this won't happen in the first place because, well, then first of all, people have to realize that your token was added and then they have to add liquidity and so on. So what you ideally want to have is you add the token pair and then at the same time you start liquidity bots, which are just making sure that your auctions always reach the threshold and are able to provide liquidity from the seller side as well as from the buyer side to continuously make sure that those auctions can run. We have also a nice API that allows you to easily retrieve the data which is available within this exchange, for example, historic price data and so on. It's also a command line interface and more statistics will be made available using other services like Alethio. We have also like a developer GitHub channel. We have a thread on ETH research if you're interested more in the science behind this exchange. You can also follow us on Twitter, and we will also start a governance forum for the DAO stack DAO, which will govern this exchange. So yeah, why do all the work? Because it's already available. So all of you can just go to this URL and you can just try it out yourself. Yeah, so that's something, it's actually done. It's nothing you have to wait for. You can just try it out whenever you want. This is, unfortunately, you don't have Ether cards, but if you want, we can send you this fake Raiden or Rinkeby Raiden token and Rinkeby Ether, and then you can just try this out yourself. A Raiden is just because, we start with Raiden. We Because we have Raiden tokens.
Why do you have Raiden tokens?
So we are friends with Raiden, and yeah, we believe in their project, so that's why. Yeah, and just to, because now it's a bit different, like I just show you the demo playing the video, just so you have an understanding of how this looks like in the end. So this is the seller interface, someone who wants to sell tokens. Oh. Okay. I hope the internet is fast enough. So someone who wants to sell tokens can use this interface to just send tokens to fund the next auction. Yeah. So here you have to be logged in with MetaMask, and then you can just select the token pair. Here in this case, it's only Raiden available. Then you go to the next screen to define the amount that you would like to sell. We tell you what the value is in Raiden tokens based on the previous auction. And then the process starts to actually transfer the token, approving the token, and so on. It's unfortunately quite a few transactions, which is still like a usability flaw in Ethereum itself. Just annoying. We're also working on solving this issue with another project, but I'm not talking about this today. And then you just have to wait for the order to be confirmed. If you guys know Shapeshift, this is very similar experience to Shapeshift, because you're just sending tokens, you're just selecting a token pair, you just send tokens, and at some point you get tokens back to whatever the market price currently is. It's exactly how Shapeshift works. Do you guys know Shapeshift?
Yes.
Okay, cool. It's the only exchange that until recently didn't require any KYC. But they also, even they had to change this now. So now there are also, like they were the only centralized exchange that didn't require KYC. Now they also have to implement KYC. Yeah, so this is it for the Dutch exchange, and yeah, I'm happy to answer questions if there are any. I think we have maybe a bit of time for questions.
To update the ETH to USD rates, there's a 30-day delay, right? Is that too long given the volatility of ETH now? I mean, like last week it was like how much? 200, and now it's like, oh man, yeah. it's not that. How do you like take this into account?
With the ETH US dollar price feed, so you only want to update this if the price feed is malicious. Yeah, it's not about like the price fluctuation is too high, this doesn't matter. It's only about, oh, maker discontinues the service, or, oh, someone attacked the service, that's why the information is not reliable anymore. And of course, you could always argue, okay, 30 days. Like, if the price feed is malicious, that's a lot of time to exploit this. And that's why we have an additional kind of backup where we define like floor and ceiling prices that we assume. So, even if the price feed fails or people try to manipulate it, it's not such a huge issue because ultimately, this price feed is only required in case you want to add new token pairs. If you want to start a new auction, depends on like how much what is the threshold to start the new auction, and to mine Magnolia tokens. So the actual big damage that would be done is more about minting Magnolia tokens. So basically, Magnolia tokens would be worthless in this scenario if someone would be able to manipulate the price feed. And in case you would not have like the ceiling and floor,
Question, since I'm not a developer or anything, but just as a candidate user of your exchange, what if I miss the bidding? So are there any like updates or like notifications you can give me before the bidding? Like for example, I wanted to buy that token or exchange it, but due to some circumstance, I wasn't able to buy it. Then I missed my chance of investment or trade. Are there any second chances, or do you have any other, policies to, prevent that or help the users in some other way?
Sure. So basically, if you are, the good thing is there's hardly this possibility of missing a trade. because we collect just all sell orders and then we just auction them off all at once. So if you're a seller, you will always you will never have the phase where you cannot sell. Yeah, you will just send your tokens and you just have to wait and then you get your tokens, like the other token in return. So there's no option that you send tokens and you couldn't participate. Because if the one auction already finished, it would just be added to the next auction. For a bidder, exactly. So then it might, like the price might be different in the next, in the other auction, but you will surely be able to sell the token. For bidders, it depends. Like there is the possibility that you send a bid and the auction was already over. In this case, transaction will just fail, and then you get a notification that it failed, and then you can just add it to the. Then you just have to wait until the next auction starts.
Would UX be a problem? Like I saw with the decentralized exchange, which was MetaMask, and like it was just people don't understand how to use it. So I feel like user experience at the end of the day becomes the biggest problem with all the decentralized exchanges.
Yeah, true. I mean, obviously, user experience is like biggest issue with dApps, I would say today.
Yeah.
Here in this exchange, we only build a user interface for sellers. So just sending a token is still not super difficult. What is maybe more difficult is to explain users why they have to wait for such a long time.
Yeah.
But I don't see an issue necessarily with the interface. Maybe why do we have to confirm so many transactions? That's another question that users will have to ask. And I agree, like this is still a big issue to be solved. But yeah, we are working on other kind of like better wallet solutions to make this easier for users.
Yeah. I just feel like that's the biggest hurdle to make anything like this work out.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I agree.
That's where like centralized exchanges started, takeover, all other solutions.
But here, for example, we also would like to actually have a bounty for building like an even simpler experience than this.
Yeah.
Just send tokens to this contract address, and at some point you get the other token sent back. So the simplest experience you can have. That's possible to implement this. Someone has to do it. and we just want to incentivize developers to do it. So we will specify it and then let you guys know. And then it would be great if one of you would just implement this. Outsourcing the work.
It's waiting for developers to do it.
You can use this mostly as a backend and actually have multiple types of frontend that are hosted on different sites, basically.
Absolutely. So again, like we said, here the big advantage is every token project can list themselves, and there are many ICO projects. They could just have a small widget on their landing page to allow users to convert this token into other tokens. Of course, ideally you should get the users where they are like most frequently going to, and this might not be our interface. So we actually want to incentivize others to build other interfaces, and there will also be bounties for this. Yeah.
When your event is actually coming up with this idea, have you considered any other manner of options? Because there are so many kinds of options, so I just wonder. I mean, your idea is very great because option is usually done when the market price is better than certain new startup tokens are exactly really good examples. But I wonder why it should be Dutch option.
That's a very good question. And you could have asked the same, or we were asked the same question even for our token sale, like why should you use a Dutch auction? You can use another auction. And that's true. You can use different types of auctions. The only reason why we go for the Dutch auction is because it is simple to implement. And the advantage is that everyone who's participating is in. Yeah. If the Dutch auction starts, anyone who's sending a bid is in. If you would, for example, use a Vickery auction or like a second price auction like on eBay, then there are always lots of people who are bidding, but they will not make it, right? Like lots of people, they're bidding on something, but ultimately someone else will get it. And then you have lots of Ethereum transactions, which all cost money, but they actually lead to nothing because they're just wasting their money. I think this is like, those are actually for this kind of use case the main advantages.
Sorry, it's possible that I just missed from your presentation, but what is the, as for the meters, what is the minimum threshold to get into a certain contract?
Yeah, so for bidders, there is basically no threshold. Like, you can participate with a super small amount. So if you want to sell, then the only requirement is that the total sell volume is over $1,000. But if you're a bidder and you're just sending in a bid, then it can be marginally low. Yeah, like then you can just get a fraction of a token.
Right.
Yeah, so that's a good thing about.
It is possible for people to actually, people not knowing each other, come together and just happens to bid on a certain coin and all together their threshold eventually goes beyond.
Exactly. Yeah, maybe that was not clear from the presentation. I agree. Like basically, on seller and buyer side, of course, lots of different people can participate simultaneously. It's not that one person sells and one person buys. It's always many sellers and many bidders most of the time.
Markets are generally irrational, isn't it? Like, hard to force rationality, because Dutch auctions try to force rationality, but markets are irrational. So you end up having like a system that doesn't necessarily work. But that's true even for centralized exchanges.
Yeah, true. Also here in this exchange, there's only one issue, or there's one possibility where the auction would lead to wrong prices, and this is if a bidder is bidding at a too high price. Basically, bidder is saying, I'm paying, I don't know, $10 for this token instead of the market price, which is $5. And then at this point, like the sellers have an incentive to participate also as bidders, to just close the auction early on and receive a higher price. But this is also only then really an incentive if you have, if you as a seller have the biggest proportion of the sell volume to actually make the effort and close this auction to have the benefit of those bidders that bid it to at a too high price. Yeah.
How would market makers work in a market like this? You don't necessarily need a market maker.
It's true. You need more like liquidity providers, just continuously starting auctions. Of course, there's still possibilities for market makers to do arbitrage between this exchange and other decentralized exchanges. It's also something we want to incentivize, basically bridging to other centralized to other exchanges, also like Kyber, for example. And the really cool thing is that you can do like such trades even within one Ethereum transaction, basically buying or selling tokens on Kyber and doing the opposite on our exchange within one Ethereum transaction. Yeah.
What were the main challenges you faced as a developer?
Yeah, I think in retrospective, the biggest challenge that we had was that we were not like the way how we developed this was we were not really clear about the specification from the beginning, and this changed quite a lot during the development process. And this is why the development took way longer than we initially anticipated. So initially we thought, okay, we actually already developed this for our own token sale, so it should not be a big deal to implement this as an exchange. And then we had more and more ideas. adding this Magnolia mining token and so on. And this, of course, made the complexity a lot bigger. Like, all those token models that I presented, implementing all of them into this exchange makes it really, really complex. Also mathematically complex, which is then prone to errors. And then you have to really spend a lot of time thinking about how can you write this in a secure way. And of course, with this complexity, like basically the higher, if it's like, I don't know, like if the more complex it gets, the exponentially more difficult it is to audit this as well, to make sure that it's actually secure. What we did for this specific smart contract is we had actually three auditors who independently did an audit, and then they basically consolidated their results. And this way, we made sure that we had a lot of feedback, basically. We also spent a lot of time on documenting it. So if you go to the official documentation that we have, you will find a 20 pages PDF file, which documents the entire smart contract system. And this also, of course, helped the auditors a lot. Yeah? If you want to have a proper audit result, which is required today to publish anything on mainnet that holds money, then first of all, you have to make sure that auditors also understand the implication of your contracts, that they actually know what they have to audit. So writing a good documentation and specification of your contracts is as important as writing the contracts themselves. We already had the experience that we asked someone to do an audit, and then he did the audit, and just afterwards he realized what actually the functionality was of what he audited. And of course, this should never happen. So be precise by implementing, specify exactly what you are doing, and then get different auditors involved in trying to basically audit this and validate that your specification actually meets your implementation. You can go even so far that you're trying to formally verify this, but this takes a lot of time and is currently, that's basically something that's probably out of scope for almost all projects. Thank you very much. I'm also available afterwards for any other questions. Thank you.